Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. One name says it. No, it's not Marilyn Miller, it's Marilyn Monroe. My guest today, Lois Banner, who is also a professor at University of Southern California, has written truly the extension, the whole life of Marilyn Monroe. The book is called Marilyn, and it's published by Bloomsbury. Welcome, Lois.
Thank you so much, Connie. I'm glad to be here.
Well, what a job you've done. The passion and the paradox.
Yes.
Yeah. You said in the beginning that you do, in a way, identify with what it must have been like growing up as she did in the Valley of Los Angeles, and being blonde, being the child of a family, and being into, you know, into, what can one say, you're living here, films, showbiz.
I also grew up in Los Angeles, in Inglewood, and I also had a brief connection with the movie industry and with Hollywood. So I was drawn to her, drawn to how a relatively ordinary girl in a very conflicted and confused family was able to make herself into a great star.
It is. I mean, it truly was confusing. The mother, Gladys, who was working as an editor, who maybe was married, maybe wasn't, to this heir to Rhode Island shipping, produces a child, but she marries just so the child is not illegitimate, has a great friend called Grace, and all of the sort of, like a spider, all of the extending people who are in the web.
Well, that is correct. Yes. Gladys was a film cutter and paster. She was on the low end of the editing totem pole. And in those days, the film was cut and pasted by hand after an editor had decided what to keep on the finished film and then what to take out. And so Gladys was not paid very much money. She was a woman who was really almost in poverty, but she was also a 1920s flapper. And being a 1920s flapper, that was the term for women in that period after the First World War, who in fact were kind of free and wild and dated a lot of men and stayed up late and drank too much. And so, and probably were sexually rather free. And she was in that crowd, and that's how she met both the Rhode Island heir to wealth and then the meter man, who was the man that she married. I'm not sure she married him to give her child a name, but she, her mother put a lot of pressure on her to marry, and Gladys was kind of a marrying woman. This was her second marriage to Mortensen, and her first marriage had been at the age of 14. Mm-hmm. And therein starts the very, very complicated story of Gladys. But then when you deal with Marilyn, almost every part of her life is filled with complicated stories of involvements and hidings and trying to do things and avoiding doing other things. It's, to my mind, having written a number of biographies, she led one of the most complex lives of any prominent woman of the 20th century.
Yeah. She is so likable in some ways, and so I don't want to know you in the other.
Absolutely, yeah. Correct. She had many sides. She could be sweet, charming, wonderful. She had a charisma. She made almost anybody she wanted to like her, want to protect her with her little girl aura. She was a great wit. She had a natural ability to tell jokes, to make fun of herself, to do puns. But she could be really very withdrawn and actually rather mean. So it depended on what Marilyn you encountered when you met her.
Interesting is that, fine, she was not in the real poor orphanage. It was one of the charity orphanages. She lived with her Aunt Grace. Mm-hmm. Her mother did buy a house. And somehow the mother had a breakdown after buying the house. Grace moves in a way, with the English family.
Yes.
And poor little Marilyn is roaming around. She does go to Emerson Junior High, which is in a good section of Los Angeles, and she learns there how to attract boys wearing the red sweater without a bra,
yes,
and turning the sweater around so everyone could see the curves.
That's correct. That's correct. As a child or a pre-adolescent, she developed early and without the curves. At 10 years of age, she was her full adult height of 5'6", and she had no curves. She was straight as a stick. And the other students made fun of her, and they called her Norma Jean, which was her real name, Norma Jean the String Bean. When she went into puberty, she developed the great beauty and the lovely, voluptuous figure. And so she turned from the ugly duckling into the swan, which is one of her first transformations from one thing into another thing. Yes, and then all the boys liked her.
And this, of course, is when she was String Bean in the lower picture there and skinny.
Uh-huh.
And it's then during the war, she's married Jim Doherty. He goes to war, and she is picked out from the factory, in a sense, to come model.
Mm-hmm. I was alive during that period in the history of this city, particularly right after the First World War, when Hollywood dominated the city. And if you were a pretty girl walking the streets, you were liable to be stopped by a photographer. In her case, she was working as a Rosie the Riveter in a factory.
Yeah.
And she was a photographer, was looking for pretty girls to photograph on the lines, on the assembly lines, and he ran across Marilyn, and that was really the start of the career.
Because she stuttered. She wasn't really made for films at that point.
No. Yeah. She desperately wanted to be an actress because her mother and her mother's friend Grace, they had wanted to be actresses in Hollywood, and of course they didn't make it because it was one in a million chance.
Yeah.
But they raised her to think that she might be a film star.
Yeah. This is one of the early pictures of Marilyn that Bruno Bernard took of her, and it's a marvelous book that his daughter Susan has put together.
Yes, yes.
And one of my favorite pictures of her is this one taken in Palm Springs when she knows she may have a savior.
Yes, right. Well, Johnny Hyde was a major Hollywood producer. I'm sorry, major
agent.
Hollywood talent agent. He wasn't a producer. And he had been responsible for the grooming of Rita Hayworth and Lana Turner, and really led them to their success. Now, when he met Marilyn, he was in his late 50s. That's not so old to us, but it was quite old then. She was in her mid-20s, but he took one look at her, fell in love with her, and then decided he wanted to make her a star. Because he was kind of not doing that much then, and he wanted to groom another star.
Well, he was a vice president at William Morris.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wife and children.
That's correct.
Left them for Marilyn.
That's correct.
Yeah.
All of that is correct. He did. And there are some authors who believe that he was responsible for Marilyn's success in Hollywood. And that particular story has a lot of truth to it. He did help her a great deal
because
in the early career.
On the other side at 20th Century Fox is Daryl Zanuck, also a short man.
That's true, too.
And he wanted no part of Marilyn.
That's right.
He thought of her as party girl.
That's correct.
Yeah. Was she a party girl?
Yes, she was. Marilyn was many things, but being a party girl was one of those things. And what that meant was that the studio used her to be an escort to men who came in from the East Coast who were theater owners and representatives and who came to Hollywood expecting to have a good time with a beautiful woman. And she did do that. And probably if she wanted to, sex was involved.
Yeah.
So
and probably a tip at the end.
Something of that sort, yes.
Yeah. Wonderful letter to her that you enclose here from Ilya Kazan.
Oh, yes.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Tell our friends about that letter.
Marilyn had this absolutely dynamic sex appeal and also this little girl appeal, and she really, and a kind of electric aura, and she did draw many men to her, yeah. And Elia Kazan had an affair with her because he loved beautiful blonde women, which she was, and yeah. He wrote a letter to her. He had a lot of respect for her. Marilyn was quite an intelligent person who read books and wanted yeah. very much to be. She says, I don't want to be an intellectual, but she fits into my definition of an intellectual. But he was with her, and then he was leaving to go back to New York, and he wrote her a really touching letter saying how much he thought she had to offer, and he tells her to stop being a party girl and to stay away from a number of men who yeah. were keeping the party girl lists and giving them to their friends, and tells her, go to college, become serious.
I like the one line where he said, don't go to parties in a taxi.
Oh, yes. Yeah. That's a great line.
Yeah, because it implied, I'll go home with anybody who asks. Don't go with strong men who want to control you. Because at the same time she was having an affair with Kazan, she was also making out with Arthur Miller.
They kind of met. Kazan introduced her to Arthur Miller in 1951, and Arthur fell for her too, and they had about a week's fling, and then Arthur felt very threatened. He didn't want to cheat on his wife, and he was too attracted to Marilyn, and so he went back to New York.
Yeah. Talk about her film career, because it was when she would suddenly be in the musicals. I mean, who forgets that How to Marry a Millionaire?
I know.
Or the Lorelei Lee in that picture with Jane Russell.
Yes. Well, Marilyn was preparing herself for a big movie career in a variety of kinds of movies. So almost from the beginning of Hollywood, of her time in Hollywood, she spent all her money on lessons, acting, singing, dancing, movement. So she was ready for whatever the Hollywood offered her. She made an early movie, which people don't know too well. It's called Ladies of the Chorus, and it was made in 1948 in her brief stint at Columbia Pictures. She's not bad in that movie. She dances, she sings, she moves beautifully. She's impressive. She is not the later very voluptuous Marilyn Monroe. She's a little girl in the movie. She's really a girl next door. But the skills, the abilities to do the things that musicals require are already there. So she yeah. had a piece of work that they did look at when they cast her in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes.
Yeah. Why did Daryl Zanuck dislike her so?